Hi, I am Dr. Selvaraj, your surgical educator from Malaysia. Welcome back to my series of surgical teaching videocasts. These are meant mainly for undergraduate medical students doing the surgical clerkship rotation. I promise you will become competent in clinical problem solving and surgical decision making if you are going to watch these videos over and over again. Today in this episode, I am going to discuss one more cause for hematuria, that is renal cell carcinoma or hypernephroma. So my objective in this presentation, or I am going to discuss this under the following subheadings. After watching this video, all of you should understand the causes for hematuria, the epidemiology, etiology, pathology, clinical features that include symptoms and signs, investigation, staging, treatment, and prognosis of renal cell carcinoma. I have also included a mind map for renal cell carcinoma and a diagnostic algorithm and a treatment algorithm. So what are the causes for hematuria? So easily you can divide it into causes in the kidney, causes in ureter, bladder, and then prostate and in the urethra. So causes in the kidney are trauma, infection, and calculus, and of course the malignant tumors also. The common malignant tumor in kidney is the renal cell carcinoma, the most common. Ureter also, again it is trauma, calculus, or urothelial cancer here. Bladder also the same thing, trauma or any infection like infective cystitis, chemical radiation cystitis, and then the bladder cancer. Bladder calculus also cause for the hematuria. Coming to urethra and prostate, it may be urethral trauma or benign prostatic hyperplasia, prostatitis can also cause hematuria. So coming to the epidemiology of renal cell carcinoma, all renal neoplasms are potentially malignant, and this renal cell carcinoma is the most lethal of all urological malignancies. The most common age group is between 40 to 60 years. It's more common in elderly male patients. Most of the RCCs will be detected incidentally while we are doing imaging for some other pathology. 80% of all kidney tumors are renal cell carcinomas. These are also known as hypernephromas, clear cell carcinomas, or Gravitz tumors. They account for 3% of all new cancer cases diagnosed in men and 2% of all cancers in women. The male to female ratio is 2:1. The incidence is increased in patients with von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. Most of the RCCs, that is renal cell carcinomas, are sporadic, unilateral, and unifocal. So coming to the etiology, it is mainly idiopathic. Exactly the cause is not known, but there are many genetic factors involved in this disease. What happens is the structural changes, especially in chromosome 3. This is the balance reciprocal translocation between the chromosomes 3p and 8q, and also hereditary papillary renal carcinoma, von Hippel-Lindau disease, and Breithaupt-Doeby syndrome. All these are causes for genetic factors for RCC. Coming to the environmental factor, the tobacco exposure or smoking is one of the important causes. And another thing is both inherited and acquired cystic disease of the kidneys. So this also can cause RCC. Coming to the pathology of renal cell carcinoma, the tumor arises from the proximal convoluted tubular epithelium. That means it is arising from the cortex of the kidney. So grass appearance, the external surface will be spherical in shape. It occupies either the upper or lower pole, but most commonly it is in the upper pole. It is unilateral and it is of moderate size, between 7 to 8 centimeter. The cut surface, it will be yellowish in color. You can see it clearly. This is yellowish in color, or it could be dull white also, like this. There will be areas of hemorrhage, cyst, necrosis, but it is not an encapsulated, tumor. So there won't be any true capsule for this tumor. Coming to the microscopic pathology, the usual scenario is you can see clear cells. These are polygonal or cubical cells with abundant cytoplasm containing cholesterol, triglycerides and glycogen. This is what you are seeing here, and here also you are seeing the same picture with abundant cytoplasm. So these are called clear. That is why this tumor is called clear cell renal carcinoma. And occasionally you can see a granular cell picture or a sarcomatoid. This is sarcomatoid and this is the granular cell appearance. But these two appearance are very rare. Coming to the other pathology, the clear cell type is the most common variety, comprising 70%. Papillary type is only 10 to 15%. Chromophobe type 5%. Granular cell type 8%. Sarcomatoid type and other type is less than 1%. So coming to the spread of the tumor, the modes of spread are either direct extension, hematogenous spread or lymphatic spread. This tumor has got special feature, that is, these tumors are prone to grow into first the renal vein and eventually it will spread to the IVC also. The hematogenous spread, especially it will go to the lungs, opposite kidney, liver, bone and adrenals. This is what you are seeing in this picture. Extracapsular, that is local invasion, may go to the adjacent nearby organs. So it will go out of the gerontous fascia, and lymphatic spread will go to the hilar lymph node and then eventually to the para-aortic lymph node. The highly vascular metastasis, sometimes it may even pulsatile. So here you can see, this is the lung metastasis. This is the characteristic cannonball appearance in the lungs. What are the clinical features of renal cell carcinoma? The classical triad of the loin pain, the grass hematuria, and a palpable abdominal loin mass is found only in 10% of the patients. So all patients are not going to have all three features. Mainly they'll be having either grass hematuria or even microscopic hematuria. So other symptoms are maybe because of advanced disease. These are weight loss, varicocele on the left side in left-sided renal cell carcinoma, fever, bilateral pedal edema and night sweats. Symptoms due to metastatic disease are bone pain, cough, hemoptysis and headache. Apart from these regular features, patient also will be having problem because of paraneoplastic syndrome. Hypertension, these patients will be having hypertension from increased renin release, erythrocytosis from increased erythropoietin, hypercalcemia, fever because of constitutional symptoms, because of excessive pyrogen production. And some of these patients may be having hepatic dysfunction because of non-metastatic, hepatic dysfunction, and this is called Stauffer's syndrome. So what are the investigation you must do to confirm the diagnosis? Number one, you can do a blood exam where you can find out the patient is anemic. So usually this anemia is normocytic and normochromic. There may be increased ESR and decreased total iron binding capacity. You must do urine exam where you will prove the presence of hematuria, either grass or microscopic. You can also do IVU and renal arteriogram. In IVU, here you are seeing an IVU picture, you will see the characteristic stretching or distortion of the renal outline. This is what you are seeing. This is the filling defect, or this is the tumor. This is distorting the renal outline. This is what you are seeing in this IVU picture. The second picture is renal arteriogram, where you can pick up any abnormal tumor vessel. This vessel is the abnormal tumor vessel that is supplying this tumor in the kidney. So you can also do ultrasound of the abdomen, where you can detect the space occupying lesion in the kidney. This will also give whether it is cystic or solid in nature. So in this ultrasound, you are seeing a space occupying lesion here. So this tumor is partly cystic, this is cystic, and this is solid also. So this is a characteristic hypernephroma picture in USG abdomen. You should also, if you are seeing a picture like this, you must do a contrast enhanced CT abdomen also, where you will be seeing the hypodense mass. Here this is the hypodense mass, which becomes enhanced on contrast injection, that is IV contrast they have given. So this tumor become enhanced. This also you can see, this is a left-sided hypernephroma. You can also detect whether it has invaded into the renal vein and the IVC. Here you are seeing the tumor has grown into the renal vein. It is going into the IVC also. You can also detect any local invasion, you can make out, and you can also find out lymphatic spread into the nearby, either the hilar or para-aortic lymph node involvement also you can pick up by doing this contrast enhanced CT abdomen. Here in the second picture you are seeing, this is a left-sided renal cell carcinoma, whereas in this picture you are seeing bilateral renal cell carcinoma on the both on the right side as well as on the left side. So you can also do chest X-ray to find out whether the patient is having this multiple secondaries in the lung. This is the characteristic classical cannonball appearance you are seeing on both the lungs. Whereas in the second picture, you are not seeing any cannonball appearance, but there is a pleural effusion on the left side. This is malignant pleural effusion. And you can also do whole body bone scan to pick up any bony secondaries. This is a scintigraphy using technetium 99 isotope. You can inject this dye and you can take a picture with gamma camera. You are seeing multiple, the technetium 99 isotope will be picked up by these bony secondaries. So you are seeing in multiple areas, here in the skull, in the pelvis, here in the vertebra also you are seeing secondaries. Usually we won't do FNAC because of fear of seeding. So but in doubtful cases, or if you are planning non-surgical treatment, then you can do FNAC to prove the diagnosis. So coming to the staging, it is called Robson staging. So stage 1, here this is the violet color, you can see this is the stage 1 tumor. This is the kidney, left kidney. So tumor is less than 7 cm in its greatest dimension, and it is limited to the kidney. It is not spread outside the kidney, and the 5-year survival rate is 95% if it is stage 1. Stage 2, the tumor is more than 7 cm, and this is also limited, this one, the blue color. So this is also limited to the kidney. The 5-year survival, now it becomes from 95, it becomes 88. So stage 3, the tumor has spread into the major veins, into the renal vein and into the IVC also. This is one thing. Tumor, but still the tumor is within gerator's fascia, or there is presence of one regional lymph node involved. The 5-year survival rate has become 59%. This is the yellow color, stage 3 here, but it hasn't gone outside the gerator's fascia. And this is also the tumor in the both in the renal vein as well as in the IVC. Stage 4, the tumor has gone beyond the gerator's fascia. See here, it has come outside the gerator's fascia, and there is involvement of more than one regional lymph node involved. The 5-year survival rate is only 20%. So coming to the TNM staging, okay, this is tumor, node, and the metastasis. So it is T1 is mainly it is less than 7 cm. So the T2 is more than 7 cm. T3 is involvement of major veins or perinephric tissue. So T1 again divided into T1A and T1B. T1A it is less than 4 cm. T1B is between 4 cm to 7 cm. T2 is also divided into T2A. It is more than 7 cm but within 10 cm. T2B, it is more than 10 cm. So in T3 also, it is T3A, T3B and T3C. So these two, T1 and T2, the tumor is limited to the kidney. Whereas in T3, it is not beyond gerotas fascia. It is just outside kidney, of course, but not crossing the gerotas fascia. In T3A, okay, no renal vein involvement, but the renal sinus, the fat, the perinephric fat is involved. Whereas in T3B, involving the vena cava, the renal vein and the vena cava. And in T3C also, okay, the same, it is involving the vena cava, but in T3B, it is below diaphragm. In T3C, okay, there are vein involvement, but it is above diaphragm. T4, okay, invasion is beyond gerotas fascia or in distant metastasis. Okay, sorry, this is not metastasis, this is local invasion, it is going outside gerotas fascia. So then coming to the lymph node, N0 means no lymph node. N1, okay, regional lymph nodes are involved. Distant metastasis, M0, no distant metastasis. M1, okay, distant metastasis present. So here, this is the actual staging. Stage 1 means T1, N0 and M0. Stage 2, T2, N0, M0. Stage 3, T1 or T2 or T3. In N1 or N0 or N1. So M0 also. So in stage 4, it is T4 or any T. N and M1. This is the TNM staging. Coming to the treatment of renal cell carcinoma, so you have to do it for localized renal cell carcinoma, advanced localized renal cell carcinoma, and advanced renal cell carcinoma. So things you have to consider. If it is localized renal cell carcinoma, so what are the treatments? So you can do radical nephrouretrectomy. This is early ligation of renal artery and vein, excision of the kidney outside gerotas fascia, excision of ipsilateral adrenal gland and proximal one off of the ureter. You have to do regional lymphadenectomy from the crest of the diaphragm to the aortic bifurcation. This is what you are seeing here. So this is for early cases, for stage 1 and stage 2. You can do this radical nephrouretrectomy. You have to remove the whole kidney and the ureter also. So nephron, you can also do nephron sparing surgery. This is the complete local resection of the renal tumor while leaving maximal amount of the normally functioning the kidney parenchyma. So this particular method is indicated if the patient is having bilateral renal cell carcinoma or renal cell carcinoma involving a solitary functioning kidney. So here you have to do nephron sparing surgery or partial nephrectomy. You have to remove the tumor along with part of the normal kidney also. You have to excise it and then you have to close this part of the kidney. So this is what is called the nephron sparing or partial nephrectomy. Suppose if the patient is having multifocal bilateral renal cell carcinoma or local recurrence after the nephron sparing surgery, or if the patient is unfit for surgery, then you can do what is called thermal ablative therapies like either cryosurgery or radiofrequency operation. So there are three approaches for radical nephrectomy. This could be done either by open method, laparoscopic method, or nowadays by robotic surgery also. But in all these approaches, the tumor size should be less than 8 cm. There shouldn't be any local invasion. There shouldn't be any renal vein involvement. And there should not be any regional lymphadenopathy also. So suppose if the tumor is locally advanced renal cell carcinoma, then that means locally advancement means it is involving the renal vein as well as the inferior vena cava. Here, this is the left-sided kidney tumor. So it has grown into the tumor has grown into the renal vein, left renal vein, and involving the IVC also. Here you can do radical nephroureterectomy, and along that you had to remove the thrombus from IVC after getting vascular control of the IVC. Here you can see it clearly. This is the tumor. The tumor has grown into the, this is on the right side. So it has grown into the right renal vein into the IVC. So you had to make an incision in the IVC after controlling the IVC with the vascular clamps. Here you can see clearly the vascular clamps. So you had to open the, the IVC, and then you had to remove the right renal vein along with the thrombus. Then you had to close this rent or the incision in the IVC. So this is one thing. Suppose if the tumor is locally invasive, so it has gone outside the renal tissue in the perinephric pad, but not cross outside the gerotas fascia. This is what is called locally invasive. Then here also you can do radical nephroureterectomy, but along with that you have to do en bloc resection of the involved organs, either the perinephric fat and the bowel or even the spleen, etc. You have to remove in en bloc resection. Suppose if there is local recurrence after radical nephrectomy or nephron sparing surgery, then you can do the thermal ablative procedures like cryosurgery or radiofrequency ablation you can do. So coming to the advanced metastatic renal cell carcinoma, what is the treatment? So you can do cytoreductive nephrectomy. Here also you can do nephrectomy, but not for the cure. It is only for palliation. So this is called cytoreductive nephrectomy. You can also go for immunotherapy with either alpha interferon or interleukin 2, or you can use LAK, that is lymphokine activated killer cells. This also you can use. All these come under immunotherapy. You can also go for what is called targeted therapy. This is what will happen. This will this will prevent the new vascular growth, therapy. This will prevent new vascularization, or neovascularization to the tumor will be prevented by these drugs. Examples are sumitinib and bevacizumab. These are the drugs we can use in targeted therapy. The main purpose is this will prevent neovascularization or new blood vessel formation or feeding vessel to the tumor will be prevented by these medicines. So coming to the prognosis, prognosis is generally good if you can remove the intrarenal neoplasm, and this will entirely cure the patient. So this is one thing. If the tumor is either stage 1 or stage 2 and it is entirely inside the renal parenchyma, then the prognosis is very good. In operable cases, 70% are well after 3 years and 60 are well after 5 years. Prognosis is bad if the tumor invasion is beyond either the renal capsule or gerotas fascia. Macroscopic involvement of either the renal vein or its tributaries or into the IVC, this is also having very bad prognosis. And the involvement of either the hilar nodes or para-aortic nodes also carry very bad prognosis. This is the mind map for renal cell carcinoma. So renal cell carcinoma, etiology, I told environmental factors and genetic factors. In environmental factors, smoking and the hereditary or acquired cystic diseases of the kidney, polycystic kidney, for example. Genetic factors, it could be von Hippel-Lindau disease or hereditary papillary renal cell carcinoma or Brittain-Duby syndrome. Coming to the pathology, the tumor arises from the proximal convoluted tubule. The direct extension is to the gerontous fascia and to other nearby organs. Hematogenous spread is to the liver, lung, brain, opposite kidney or to the bones. Lymphatic spread is to the hilar nodes or to the para-aortic nodes. Clinical features, the classical triad is a renal mass, that is loin mass, hematuria and a flank pain or loin pain. Other features are, in advanced cases, patient may have left varicocele. If it is a left-sided renal cell carcinoma, patient also can have pedal edema and weight loss and loss of appetite. If it is distant metastasis, if it is to the bone, okay, patient will be having bony pain. If it is to the lung, okay, patient may have either cough or hemoptysis. If it is to the brain, patient may have headache. So coming to the investigation, you must do a urine exam to confirm presence of hematuria, either grass or microscopic. You must do ultrasound abdomen to pick up a space-occupying lesion in the kidney. You can also confirm whether the tumor is cystic or solid. You must also do a contrast-enhanced CT, and this is the gold standard investigation, where it will reveal a hypodense kidney mass, and you can also pick up the local invasion or whether it has involved the renal vein and the IVC. Also, you can make up by doing doing a contrast-enhanced CT. Staging, there are two systems. One is Robson staging and another one is TNM staging. Coming to the treatment, you have to divide it into localized RCC, locally advanced renal cell carcinoma or advanced renal cell carcinoma. If it is localized renal cell carcinoma, okay, you can do a radical nephroureterectomy or nephron-sparing partial nephrectomy. Or if the patient is unfit for surgery, you can go for thermal ablation procedures like radiofrequency ablation and cryosurgery. If it is locally advanced renal cell carcinoma, you can do radical nephroureterectomy. Plus, apart from that, if it is IVC invasion, you have to remove the thrombosis from the IVC. If it is local invasion, you must do, apart from radical nephroureterectomy, you must do N-block resection of lymph node and the involved organs also. If it is advanced renal cell carcinoma, you can do what is called cytoreductive nephrectomy. You can do immunotherapy with alpha interferon or LAK. And you can also do targeted therapy using sumitinib and bevacizumab. These are newer drugs. This will prevent neovascularization to the tumor. So this is the diagnostic algorithm for hematuria. So in hematuria, you have to, do the thorough history and physical examination. If it is a painless hematuria, okay, you can examine the midstream urine, you can do cytology, you can do cystoscopy, and you can go for IVU also. So most of these painless hematuria are, you can pick up malignancy anywhere in GI tract. It could be in the kidney or it may be in the bladder. So suppose if it is painful hematuria, here also you have to examine the midstream urine. If it is positive for culture, the cause is UTI. If it is negative for the culture, then you do IV urogram. If it is delayed excretion of the dye, then it is because of the calculus. This is ureteric calculus. Calculus is mostly in the ureter only. Suppose if the IVU is normal, then you can do cystoscopy and you can find the diagnosis, either a calculus in the bladder or tumor in the bladder or any pathology in the prostate also you can pick up. So this is the treatment algorithm. This is renal cell carcinoma. This is localized. So if the tumor is less than 3 cm, you have to do biopsy, okay, histopathology, you have to confirm. You have to do all the clinical parameters. If the patient is having low risk renal cell carcinoma because it is less than 3 cm, so you can do what is called active surveillance. If it is high risk renal cell carcinoma, then you can do radical nephroureterectomy and you can also do active surveillance. Suppose if the tumor is more than 3 cm, here also you have to prove it by biopsy, then you have to do the clinical parameters also. Even in low risk RCC, if it is more than 3 cm, you must do a radical nephroureterectomy with active surveillance also you have to do. And high risk RCC, you must do surgery with active surveillance. Apart from that, you can go for adjuvant immunotherapy and adjuvant targeted therapy. Suppose if the tumor is already metastatic, here also you have to confirm it with histopathology. You have to do all the clinical parameters. If it is an operable tumor, go for elective cytoreductive nephrectomy, not radical nephrectomy. Our aim is only palliation, so you have to do what is called cytoreductive nephrectomy. You can also try neoadjuvant immunotherapy and neoadjuvant targeted therapy. Neoadjuvant means you have to give this immunotherapy and targeted therapy even before this cytoreductive nephrectomy. That is what is called neoadjuvant. Then after that, you can also try single targeted therapy or multiple targeted therapy or single immunotherapy. If the tumor is inoperable, okay, you can do all these things. So thank you very much for watching this video. If you think that these videos are very useful, kindly subscribe to this channel and share these videos in your social media. Thank you once again for watching this video. Let us meet once again in another video. Until then, bye-bye.